talked quite a bit of detail about it. So I just have to put them all together, you know, and formulate it in terms of human conduct. So if you remember, we were talking about right understanding, you know, in module 2, and we are trying to unfold the details about right understanding. So if you recall, this is what we were saying, that as a human being, we desire for continuous happiness, and this continuous happiness is ensured by right understanding, right feeling, and right thought. And this right feeling and right thought is what we were calling as devolution. And then we said, to be resolved is to have the clarity of all these, you know, aspects of our living as human beings, starting from right understanding to ensuring a human tradition. And we were trying to detail out this clarity of, you know, each of these aspects. And we had started with right understanding. So if you recall, we are now trying to unfold this right understanding till now. You know? So in last around 16 lectures, we have tried to unfold right understanding. And next two lecture also we'll continue with this unfolding of right understanding. So if you look at that, we said right understanding, if you see what is, you know, some details about who is the knower and what are the things to be known and what is the process of knowing. We found out that things to be known is the whole existence, but the sequence in which this unfolding can be done is, you know, starting with knowledge of human being, particularly the self, the knowledge of existence. And on the basis of these two, we can know about the human conduct. So till now in module 3, we have tried to explain, you know, explore into this knowledge of human being. In module 4, we have tried to explore into knowledge of existence. And now in this module 5, we are trying to explore into knowledge of human conduct. So this is what we intend to do now in the context of understanding the, you know, what right understanding is, effectively. So let us look at this human conduct. As I said, we have already done a lot of, you know, kind of exploration, investigation about, you know, the human being, about the existence, and about the role of human being in this existence. So if we recall all that and put together, okay, we can now understand what is the meaning of human conduct, or what the human conduct is like. So we have written this down. In the process of knowing, we have investigated into knowledge of human being and knowledge of existence. On the basis of knowing the above two, now we want to investigate into knowledge of human conduct. We can look at the human conduct from different angles. We will look into two formulations, model one and model two. So what I'm saying is that when we try to formulate this human conduct, there are different ways in which it can be formulated. It can be articulated. So depending upon our angle, we will formulate it, articulate it differently. In fact, interestingly, if you look at this B1, where this coexistence, harmony, and relationship is being explored, that part is definite, continuous, universal. So there is not much of, you know, kind of issue of angle. Okay. When it comes to your imagination, B2, right, then there is some possibility of variety. On the basis of this imagination will be this, you know, desire or feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence. But when it comes to working out the detail of how to fulfill it in the world outside, then there is a scope of having varieties. When it comes to behaving with the world outside, or working with the world outside, or participating with the world outside, there are still more variations possible. So in that sense, we are saying, depending upon our angle of perception, we may have different formulations. For example, if I am focusing on my own self, on my as a human being, and now I'm trying to look at the human conduct, there will be one kind of formulation. But if I consider that the society is important and we must keep this society at the center, and from there we should decide about the human conduct, then probably our formulation about the human conduct will be different. The basis will remain same. This basis of right understanding, where we are able to see the harmony, the relationship, the coexistence, that will remain same. But depending upon the emphasis, of perceiving it for the individual at the center or for society at the center, our formulations will look different. So what we will do is, we will look into two possible formulations. We are calling them as human conduct model 1 and human conduct model 2. But there can be many more formulations. There can be many more formulations. In fact, this clarity that there are many formulations possible regarding human conduct has to be clear to us, because so much of variety of thoughts, which prevail in the society today, and so many kind of systems of practice, so many traditions, so many kind of way of living, which have been proposed and which have been followed by different set of people, can be understood only in the light of this clarity that though the basis is same, that relationship, harmony and coexistence is same, when you go about formulating the details of how to perform in this world today, that is the human conduct, there can be variety. There can be different formulations. That does not mean that they are, in opposition to each other. That only means that depending upon different angles that they have taken, they have formulated this human conduct in different manners. And that has been passed on to the next generation and next generation. With understanding, or many times without understanding, with assumption. So when it is passed on without understanding and with assumption, it starts becoming rigid. And we keep thinking that this is the only way of human conduct. And then we are in opposition with others who also think otherwise. And then there is so much of fight and so much of differences and so much of opposition. So this clarity that human conduct can be formulated in different manner, depending upon the angle that we are taking and depending upon the situations, the circumstances in which we are in the society. So let us look at this model 1 of human conduct. Then next session we'll talk about this model 2 also. In model 1, we will look into what we have been seeing as role of human being. So if you remember in the last session, we were trying to identify the role of human being. And this is what is shown here in the next slide. So this is the role of human being that we identified in this existence. And as I said, that we have tried to understand the human being first, then the existence, and then after having understood these two, we have tried to understand the role of human being in this existence. And if we can understand the role of human being in this existence, then that essentially will be the human conduct. So it is not that you have to do something extra. If you can see yourself, understand yourself, if you can understand the existence, then you can see what is going to be your role in this existence. And if you can see your role of you in the existence, then that is what you have to perform. Right? That is what you have to do, and that is human conduct. So we will look into this, right, in the form of human conduct. It must be mentioned again that what here again we have two possibilities. When we are talking about this model one, there are two possibilities. One possibility is when we are moving towards the higher activities of the self. Right. Second is that we have reached to the highest activity of the self, and from there moving down, right? So if you look at the activity of self, we might start with selecting and testing, and then move up to analyzing and comparing, and so on. So that will be one model, that when I am moving up to my higher activities of the self, how will I perform in my behavior, in my work, in my participation? And the other is that if I am coming down from realization, that is, I had the realization, the highest activity of the self, from there I am coming down to understanding, to contemplation, to comparing, to testing, and so on, then how do I perform? How do I perform? And if you look at the formulation that we have been taking right from the beginning, is connected to the possibility two of model one. So the second possibility of model one is what we have been placing in all our discussion, right from our understanding of human being. So we will start with that second possibility of model one, that is conduct when we are moving downward from the highest activity of the self, that is realization. And this is what represents the complete human conduct, that is the best of human conduct that we can have. So we will try to understand that, begin with that. And at the end of this session, we'll briefly mention about the first possibility of model one. That is, how do we perform when we are moving towards higher activities of the self? So that is our condition basically, that we are at the step of lower activities, or we are slowly moving to the higher activity. In that case, how do we perform? How do we practice so that we can move up? In fact, if you look at the practice sessions, exercise one and exercise two, that is basically trying to describe the first possibility of model one, where we are slowly trying to see this relationship, harmony and coexistence. And then we are trying to set our imagination, our desire, thoughts in line with this relationship, harmony and coexistence. And then we are trying to behave in accordance with that. So that we will mention briefly when in the last part of the session. But first part, we will talk about this model one, the second possibility, that is the conduct of human being when we are moving downwards from the highest activity of self, that is realization. We have purposely done this because this will provide us the standard, the highest possibility of human conduct. And once we have this highest, you know, possibility of human conduct, then from there we can get back, you know, to where we are, and then work out how we reach to that, you know, highest possibility. So we have now fixed up the goal, and way back we are now trying to find out our own state of human conduct, and then we are trying to work out how we can move from this point to that targeted point, to that complete human conduct or highest possibility of human conduct. So that will give us a feel to where we have to reach and how we have to reach. So it is important to decide where we have to reach. That clarity is necessary. That highest possibility of human conduct has to be clear to us so that we know where we have to reach. And by evaluating our present condition and this highest possibility, we can work out the steps through which we can move. So let's look at this, the second possibility of module one. We will try to investigate into each step of expression of human conduct, starting from activity of realization. So we have this realization, and with this realization, now we are moving down, right? So we will try to investigate into each step of this expression of human conduct, starting from the activity of realization. So let us do that. I will briefly mention about each of these steps because it is important to understand what is happening there, right? So we have the realization of coexistence, and we are beginning to come down from there, right, to perform in the world outside. So at the level of realization, we have the realization of space. So there is an arrow moving up. See, so we have the realization of space, and we have the realization of coexistence. We have the realization that every unit in existence is in space, is submerged in space, right? And that way the whole existence, the whole nature is in the form of units being submerged in space. So I have this realization in me that existence is in the form of coexistence, that every unit in existence is submerged in space. Right? So I have the realization of the space and realization of coexistence. With this realization, I take the decision in favor of living with this coexistence. And this decision is what is called as authentication. That now I can see that the existence is in the form of coexistence. Therefore, I decide to live with this coexistence, live with the world, you know, with the whole existence, on the basis of this coexistence. So this is what is called as authentication. Now when I have taken this decision and now I am working for it, in the process I will try to understand every unit in existence, because I have to live with those units, right? So I have to understand the every unit ultimately I have to understand all the units in nature. So I have to understand the units, and in that unit, I have to understand the self-organization of unit. So I have to understand my own self-organization, my innateness, my harmony. And I have to understand the harmony, the self-organization, the innateness of every other unit in nature. Ultimately, I have to understand the harmony in nature as a whole, the self-organization of the nature as a whole. And that is what we are calling as understanding. So when we are able to see this harmony, the self-organization, this innateness of every unit, every order, and the whole nature, we are calling it as understanding. With this understanding, I take the decision in favor of living with this harmony, living with this self-organization at my own level and at the level of every unit in existence. That is what is called as determination. So if I have the realization, authentication is a natural outcome of it. If I have this authentication, I will work for understanding the harmony of each of the units, self-organization of each of the units, self-organization of the nature as a whole. So understanding is a natural process which will be born out of it. When I have the understanding of harmony, I will naturally take the decision in favor of living with that harmony, with that self-organization. So determination is a natural outcome of understanding. With this determination, when I am trying to ensure living with harmony in myself and with every unit, I have to see my relationship, I have to understand my relationship with every unit in existence. And that is contemplation. So I contemplate over seeing my relationship with every unit in existence. It might start with seeing my relationship with other human beings because they are the nearest to us with whom we are interacting regularly. Then we have to see our relationship with the rest of nature, including the body. So if I want to live in harmony with every unit in existence, in myself and with every other unit in existence, then I have to understand the relationship, my relationship with every unit in existence. I also have to understand what is my participation in this whole order of nature, in this harmony of nature. So these two things, my participation in the larger order of nature and my responsibility in relationship. So that is the point of contemplation. That is the issue of contemplation. So when I have this contemplation, I have clarity of relationship, of natural characteristic, of my participation in the larger order. This all put together is block B1. That is what we are calling as right understanding. Right? That is what we are saying is definite, is universal, is continuous. And this is the foundation of human conduct. So realization of coexistence, realization of submergence, understanding of harmony in nature, the self-organization, the innateness of every unit in nature, and contemplation of clarity of relationship, natural characteristic, participation in the larger order. These are the three clarity that we obtain in the block, this violet block B1. And this clarity, this understanding is something very definite, something continuous, something universal in nature. And this provides the foundation for human conduct. So depending upon whatever be the model that you are taking, or human conduct, whatever formulation you are taking, this is there at the base. If this is not there in the base, then there is no way to formulate human conduct in a correct manner. So we have to see whether we are able to ensure this or not. We also have to see whether it is desirable to ensure this or not. If we can see that this is what is desirable, right? And later on, we can see that this is what is feasible. Then we can see that this is something which will be there whenever we are trying to understand human conduct. Whenever we are trying to formulate, articulate human conduct in any particular situation. Any particular situation of the existence, any particular situation of the society. We have to have this clarity in us. We have to have this clarity in us. And this is what I have been saying, that these two things, you know, truth and love. And as an expression of this love, compassion, three things have been there at the basis of all the thought processes, all the philosophy, all the systems of, you know, exploration that we had in the past. So whomever we have called as, you know, a great person, a realized person, right? And which have given rise to different systems, traditions in the world. These three things are common. This understanding of the truth, realization of the truth, realization of the coexistence. Number one. Number two, feeling of being related to all, the feeling of love. And the third, responsibility towards the fulfillment of that relationship, that is compassion. So this truth, love and compassion has been something very common to all systems of thoughts, all systems of practice, all traditions in the world. So this is something very common, right, which is there as the base of human conduct. With this base, now we can see how it expresses itself at the level of imagination. How it expresses itself, this clarity, this understanding, expresses itself at the level of imagination. So when we are talking about human conduct, it is important to see not only the basis, the basic foundation, but also to see how it expresses at the level of my imagination, at the level of my feeling, at the level of my thought, and finally how it expresses itself at the level of my behavior, at the level of my work, at the level of my participation in the larger order. So we have talked about the, you know, what is happening at the level of V1, at the level of right understanding, which provides the basis of human conduct. Now let us look at what is happening at the level of imagination. What is happening at the level of desire and thought and expectation. So now we can see that once we have this clarity of relationship, of natural characteristic, of participation in the larger order. Once we have the clarity of harmony, the self-organization, the innateness of every unit, And once I have the clarity of coexistence, then my desire is guided by this. So that small red arrow is essentially indicating that whatever clarity I had in block B1, the block of right understanding, that is guiding my desire. So now my desire is to live in relationship, in harmony, in coexistence. That becomes my desire. And that desire is definite. That desire is definite. And this is the crux. That without this clarity, without this understanding, our desires are not definite. Our desires are not definite. They keep changing. They keep fluctuating. They keep expanding or contracting. But with this understanding, in B1, right? Now our desire has become definite, and there is a desire to live in relationship, harmony, and coexistence. Right? There is a desire now to live with or to be in harmony, in relationship, in coexistence, which essentially means that at the level of desire, now we have the feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence. And of course, not otherwise. So even when you are moving from down to up, this is the point where we have to start checking. At the level of desire, at the level of feeling. What is my feeling? Feeling of relationship, harmony, coexistence, or feeling of opposition, contradiction, and struggle? This is the crucial place, you know, this desire is the crucial place where we have to start evaluating ourselves, whether we are moving from up to down or we are trying to move from down to up. So even when we are moving from down to up, this desire is there, and there I can ask myself, what is my desire for? Is it for relationship or opposition? What is my feeling? Is it for relationship or feeling of opposition? Similarly, feeling of harmony or feeling of disharmony, feeling of coexistence or feeling of struggle. So if understanding has taken place, then it will guide the desire, and that desire will be different. If understanding has not taken place, right, there are innumerable possibilities. But we can start asking this even now, you know, even when we are moving up, and we don't have the understanding, right? We can prima facie see that it is the relationship, harmony, and coexistence which is naturally acceptable to us and not otherwise. In that case, we can evaluate whether we have the desire, the feeling which is in line with this relationship, harmony, and coexistence, or it is otherwise. So we'll come back to this when we are discussing about moving from down to up. But I just mentioned this because this is a very crucial connection. The desire is the crucial point which is guiding the imagination. And this desire now has to be guided. So if we have the right understanding, this desire is guided by this right understanding, right? If we do not have right understanding, this desire is guided by assumptions, which we have been talking about. So I'm not going back to that, but when we'll discuss about moving from down to up, then probably we can refer back to that. So presently we are saying we have the understanding of relationship, harmony and coexistence, and this is guiding our desire. So this desire is definite, continuous, universal in nature. Now with this desire, you know, with this feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence, now I am trying to think, right? Think on the about how to fulfill this desire. How to fulfill this desire, this feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence. So that is the content of thought. That is the content of comparing and analyzing. And now if you see this, look at this basis of comparing, basis of thinking, right? That basis will also become the coexistence, the harmony, the relationship. So this is important, that now while I'm thinking of how to live with relationship, harmony and coexistence, the very basis of comparing thinking is now becoming coexistence, harmony and relationship. And if that happens, then this basis will start guiding our basis which we had previously, you know, when we didn't have the right understanding. So we had the basis of senses. Something is appealing to the senses, we will go for it. If it is not appealing to the senses, we will not go for it. Or the basis was health or profit. We were trying to maximize our profit. That was our basis of thinking. So before, the basis was either the senses or health or profit. Now the basis becomes the coexistence, the harmony, the relationship. And under the guidance of this now, I will place this basis of senses, health and profits. And we have talked about this. That now I will think in terms of right utilization of the body. I will think in terms of right utilization of the physical facility. I will think in terms of right utilization of the sensation also. And this right utilization will be decided or evaluated on the basis of coexistence, harmony and relationship. That is, whether it contributes to coexistence or not, to harmony and relationship or not. If it contributes, then this basis of senses, health and profit is also put to good use, right, to fulfill this desire, this feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence. But then it has to be guided by coexistence, harmony and relationship. That has to be basis for our comparing, right? And keeping that in the as the basis, then we can use the senses, the health, the profit, you know, under the guidance of this. And that will be the right utilization of all this. So we did talk about it. We said that senses now will be used for ensuring the health of the body and ensuring, or at least helping, the process of sharing our knowledge and our feelings. So now senses are put to right use, they are rightly utilized. They are not utilized now for getting continuity of happiness, because that does not happen. So my thought, my analyzing and comparing is done on the basis of coexistence, harmony and relationship. And the thinking is for ensuring this desire, this feeling of living with relationship, harmony and coexistence. So when I'm doing this comparing on the basis of this, my analysis, my decision, you know, will be to live with this in this manner. And that will, you know, guide my testing and selecting. So now when I'm interacting with the world outside, my testing and selecting is guided by my comparing and analyzing, which is on the basis of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. So now my testing and selecting, you know, in my interaction with the world outside is going to be guided by coexistence, harmony, and relationship. And I will put my sensation also under the guidance of this. So my sensation will be rightly utilized to ensure harmony, coexistence, harmony, and relationship. So we have been taking this example that when a mother is cooking food for the child, of course, she is taking care of the taste of the food, so senses. She is taking care of the health of the child. And she is certainly taking care of the physical facility, the food that she is preparing. But all this she is doing for relationship. For fulfillment of relationship, fulfillment of feeling of care for the child. Fulfillment of the feeling of affection for the child. So now all this cooking food is guided by the feeling in relationship, guided by affection, by care. That is why you can see that she will cook food with all devotion and feed the child first, not eat herself first. So it is not trying to get this happiness out of the food, out of the taste of the food, but it is for the fulfillment of relationship, fulfillment of feeling of relationship. So both at the level of thinking and at the level of selecting and testing, you can see that this mother cooking the food is guided by the desire, the feeling of relationship with the child. So this coexistence, harmony, and relationship is guiding my desire, and this desire is guiding my thoughts, my comparing and analyzing. And this thought, which is now guided by coexistence, harmony, and relationship, is guiding my selecting and testing, which has to do with my interaction with the world outside. So my interaction with the world outside is also guided by coexistence, harmony, and relationship. And the sensation is rightly utilized for this purpose. I still take the help of the sensation because it is something important and which can be put to right use. But this is put to right use under the guidance of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. With this, when I do the testing and selecting, right, what I do with the world outside, so if you see, till now we were talking about the self and what is happening in the self. Now we are interacting with the world outside through the body. So there is an interaction between the self and the body in the next step. And then in the next step, there'll be some interaction with the body and the world outside. And as a result, something will happen at the level of world outside. So look at this interaction with this, with, you know, the cell with the body. So this small red arrow below that, you know, just above the body, below that selecting. So having selected how to interact with the world outside, now I'm giving some instruction to the body. Right? I'm expressing my decision at the level of imagination through the body. So if you look at this, at the level of body, I express in terms of behavior or work or participation. So what we are responding with the world of world outside through the body is that at the level of body, we are expressing it as behavior. And this behavior is with other human beings. Or I'm expressing it in terms of some work with rest of nature. or I'm expressing it in terms of my participation in the larger order. Maybe starting from the family or the village or the nation. And when I'm interacting through the body, I'm interacting with the world outside. So we have mentioned that we have the behavior through the body with human being, work through the body with rest of nature, and participation in the larger order, starting from family to world family. So this is how it will express itself. And if this behavior, this work, and this participation is guided by coexistence, harmony, and relationship, and if sensation is rightly utilized for this purpose, then it will result into mutual happiness, mutual prosperity, and fulfillment of human goals. So first we have discussed about what will happen at the level of self. Right? If self has the realization of coexistence and it is coming down up to selecting and testing, what will happen at the level of self that we have discussed. Then we said what will happen at the level of body is expression in terms of behavior, work, and participation. And with this, what will happen at the world outside, right? So when I'm interacting with the human being, that is what I'm calling as behavior, the outcome will be mutual happiness, my happiness as well as happiness of the other human being. Similarly, when I'm working with rest of nature, and the outcome of it is mutual prosperity. That is my prosperity as well as the prosperity of rest of nature. And when I'm interacting and participating in the larger order, starting from, let's say, family, the village, and so on, then outcome of this is fulfillment of human goal. So this is going to be the outcome in the world outside. And what we said in addition is that if I expand this participation up to the whole existence, the whole nature, the whole world, then it will result into undivided society and universal human order. So this undivided society is an expression of my living with the feeling of relationship, feeling of affection, feeling of love, showing itself in the form of behaving in a manner which leads to mutual fulfillment. And if I do that, the other feels related to me. At least I always feel related to the other. And if I expand this right up to the world family, we will have an undivided society. Similarly, when we are participating in the larger order, starting from family to village and so on, it will give rise to universal human order. So this will be my conduct outside, and this will be the result of my conduct outside with all my expansion, the human society and universal human order. And we are saying that if we have the continuity of this generation after generation, then we will have this human tradition. So at the level of world outside, there are three achievements: the undivided society, the universal order, and the human tradition. This is the widest possibility through my human conduct. So if you look at the whole expression of human conduct, of human living, it starts with realization of coexistence, and it is completed with authentication of universal human order, human tradition. So this is the total expression of human conduct. This is the complete human conduct. This is the standard human conduct that we can see, we can understand, and we can work on it. This is what we have been trying to understand, trying to explain, trying to be with it, trying to practice for it, and all that. So now if you look at the whole course on VHB1, now VHB2, ultimately the idea has been to be able to identify this human conduct, this living of human being in this whole existence in a manner which is fulfilling for human being and which is fulfilling for the whole nature, the whole existence. So with all our exploration, investigation in UHB1 and now in UHB2, we are able to see what is the form of human conduct, what is the complete human conduct. And once we have this clarity, then you know how to go about ensuring this human conduct, complete human conduct in myself, starting from where I am. This is a brief description that I have placed here. Let me also place that if I have this human conduct, you know, then at the level of self, I will have this bliss, the satisfaction, the peace, the happiness, and ultimately that super bliss. This I have briefly mentioned in the last two class sessions, but to connect with, you know, what is the achievement of the human conduct, I can repeat saying that the achievement of human conduct at the level of self is in the form of continuous happiness, which is in the form of bliss, satisfaction, peace, and happiness. And the expression of this human conduct, complete human conduct, outside is that I am able to live with mutual happiness with human beings through my behavior. I am able to work with rest of nature, ensuring mutual prosperity. And I am able to participate in the larger order, ensuring the fulfillment of human goal. And ultimately, with expansion, this behavior, this work, this participation in the larger order of myself with the world outside in an expanding manner will result into undivided society and universal human order, which will result into the human tradition. So this is what is going to happen if I work for this human conduct, complete human conduct. And that is what we have been trying to do also. We have been trying to understand the human being, understand the existence, understanding the role of human being in this existence. All that is done with this perspective, that ultimately I am able to understand the human conduct and be with it. And if I understand it and be with that human conduct, it is fulfilling for me at the level of self. It is also fulfilling for every human being around, and it is ultimately fulfilling for every unit in nature, every unit in whole existence. This is refreshed, so I'm not going into the detail. The only thing we said that B1 is identified as right understanding block. B2 is identified as the block of imagination, right, the thought block. This B3 is identified as the block of behavior, and B4 is identified as the block of work and participation in the larger. So there is nothing new, just a kind of block, you know, putting it in the form of blocks, which we may use later. So this is where we are, you know, starting from realization of coexistence. We are coming down to the level of testing and selecting. From there, coming down to expressing it through the body, and then, you know, getting some result at the level of world outside, you know, and finally to its fullest expansion. If we have this human conduct, of course, there will be many questions on this. So I will take up the questions after this. So we have closed with the content. So if we look at this human conduct, then all that we have been talking about as clarity about the resolution, the first three class that we talked about in this EHB2, we can now place them in this context, and they look like this. So this 3.1 is having the right understanding. That whole block, clarity of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. So 3.1 is about this whole block of B1, right? Clarity of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. That is what is right understanding, we said. 3.2 is having the clarity about the human goal. So basically having the clarity about my participation in the larger order. 3.3 is about the science, that is working out how to fulfill the human goal. So my imagination now has to do with this, how to fulfill the human goal, which is decided at the level of 3.2, at the level of contemplation. With this, I will behave with human being in a mutually fulfilling manner. That is 3.4. I will work with rest of nature, ensuring mutual prosperity. That is 3.5. Then I will participate in the larger order. That is 3.6. Right? You remember this? Let me recall that. Yes, this is where we are. 3.1 is right understanding, 3.2 is wisdom, 3.3 is science, 3.4 is behavior, 3.5 is work, and 3.6 is participation in the larger order. So now I can place all that in my framework of complete human conduct. Similarly, this universal, you know, undivided human society, the universal human order, and human tradition, in which human goal is fulfilled generation after generation. So this is 3.4, 5, and 6. With this, it results into undivided human society, universal human order, and human tradition. So that is 3.7, 3.8, and 3.9. And then you have this 1.0. This is about fixing the goal, the target, the basic desire. So basic desire is for happiness, prosperity, for continuous happiness. So this goal is what is one. So that is how we can see all the clarity that we call for, or we call, you know, require, regarding these 9 aspects of human existence, can be fulfilled through the human conduct, through the complete human conduct. And that is their placement. So these 9 aspects of human conduct or human, you know, distance can be placed in this human conduct, complete expression of human conduct. And if we have this, we also said that now this conduct, you know, can be placed in the overall scheme of the existence. And if you do that, this is how it looks. So we said that existence has anyway unfolded itself up to this human order, you know, the evolution of human order. Now human being has to work through, you know, their exploration there, and, you know, investigation to have the right understanding, number one, to have the right feeling and right thought, that is B2. With that, to ensure this behavior, work and participation in the larger order, which has been just discussed. So if that is happening, then we'll ultimately have the universal human order, which is the completion point of human existence, as well as the completion of the existence as a whole. So this universal human order, this human tradition, is a completion point of the human existence. But we can see that this is also the completion point of the whole existence, because this existence as coexistence is unfolding itself, and it has already unfolded itself up to the existence of human order. The further expression of coexistence has to take place through the human being. It has to take place through the human being. And there it starts with the realization of this coexistence in existence. And then it goes down to understanding of harmony and relationship and so on. And ultimately, it results into universal human order, which is the completion point of the universal human order, right? Major part of which has already taken place, but it has to be completed by the human being. So with this human conduct, we'll be able to complete the process of unfolding of coexistence. And of course, we'll complete our own unfolding as human existence, as human being. So this is the meaning of human conduct, model one, the complete human conduct. So I have placed this proposal for you to reflect on, to investigate, and to, you know, if we are able to understand it, to ensure it in ourselves. But of course, there'll be many questions, so I'll place, you know, this and open it for question. But before that, let me mention two more things. Number one, we have talked about this possibility too. Right? Now we need to work on the first possibility of model one. That is how the human conduct will look like when we are moving from lower activities to the higher activity. So now that we have the standard of how the human conduct is, you know, the complete human conduct is. Now when we are moving from down to up, starting from selecting and testing, how will it look like when I'm moving up and how my conduct will, you know, be there outside? So that we will talk about. And second is, now that the time is almost up, so we'll not take it up right now. We may take it in the next session. But before opening the question, this is the diagram about when we are moving from lower activity to the higher activity, but we'll discuss it tomorrow. But before opening to question, let me put these points for self-reflection. Observe your current conduct and investigate whether it is aligned to human conduct or not. So very simple point to reflect. Identify the areas where your conduct is not completely human. Detail out what you are thinking to do about it. So wherever there is completeness, what is your plan? How are you going to work for it? Third, at present, what do you think of the scope of your participation or conduct? That is, till which level of your living you think of your participation? The family, the society, the country, the nature, or entire existence. Four, with how many people are you able to see and accept your relationship unconditionally and continuously? That is, you have the natural feeling for them, like trust, respect, in continuity, and you are able to respond and not react in all conditions. So reflect on these points. With this, I will open the question. Your questions are welcome.